Hi, my name is Gagandeep Singh Chadda and my project is Twitter Spam Detection. I'm doing this project as a part of the Pattern Recognition course in the University of Florida. I like to start by telling us about the different social media that we're surrounded by. Social media has now become a part of every aspect of our life, and especially where the part of collecting information. So no one has the time today to look at the newspaper or look at the news. With the advent of smartphones, collecting information from social media has become very convenient and is slowly starting to replace the traditional means of gathering information. But with any technology, there are some disadvantages associated with it too. Hurtful gossip, cyberbullying, and spam are one of the most common forms of disadvantages of Twitter, and in this project I'm going to be focusing on detection of spam in Twitter. So what is spam? Spam involves broadcasting messages to a large number of users at the same time. This means that it forces people to look at information they have no interest in, and thereby it decreases the user experience. Now why do we care about it? Cause it causes billions of daily losses in productivity. It may infect computers of different users that may are unaware of such problems that can be caused by this, and it may even lead to stolen credentials, which in the long run could cause a loss of a lot of money for the user. Social networks like Twitter generate revenue by advertising, but some companies, they go for illegal methods like spam accounts for their advertising, which is a huge loss to Twitter. It also causes a lot of frustration to user by decreasing their user experience, and may therefore lead a loss of customers to Twitter as well. Now, Twitter already has a spam detection algorithm that focuses on criteria such as harmful links, aggressive following behavior, posting to trending topics, posting duplicated tweets, low profile activity. But the problem is that spammers are clever and they have already evolved from these techniques. So now they already know how to avoid Twitter's detection algorithm. Now, what are the different types of spam that we can see on Twitter? The short URL is one of the most common spams that we can notice. This is because of the small character constraint, 140 character constraint of Twitter. Everyone has to shorten their links by using short URLs, and therefore one cannot identify which website they are going to. Spammers use this to their advantages to trick people into clicking their links and visiting sites that may have malicious content and are not what they are advertising in the tweet. Hijacking is another problem in which people's accounts are hijacked if they are not careful about the username and password credentials, and this may lead to either losing their account or they tweeting things that they are not meant to tweet. Their hashtags on trend topics is the by far the most common type of spam that can be encountered. Hashtags are used to increase the visibility of any topic or any tweet on Twitter. So when a topic is trending, this means that many people are viewing it. Spammers use hashtags on those topics so that their tweets can reach all those people that are looking at the trending topic right now, and this increases their their vision of the view of their tweet by manifold. Tweetjacking is similar to hashtags in on trend topics in the fact that they also try to increase the visibility of their tweets. In tweetjacking, a spammer will tweet to an unknown user so that his tweet appears in the newsfeed of all those people that are following that particular person. This leads to filling up the newsfeeds of people with unwanted spam and deteriorates the user experience. The solution approach I am suggesting has four stages. The first stage is collecting ground data, which includes collecting the ground truth. Second is training the classifier. Then in the third stage, we test if the classifier is good enough to use in the system or not. If so, then we go on to the fourth stage, which is classifying live data, live unlabeled data that we get from Twitter. in data collection, which is the first step, we are splitting that data collection into two parts. The first part is collection of ground truth, and the second part is collection of live Twitter stream. The ground truth can be connected from the internet, and it is used as a basis to train the classifier. So once this ground data is collected, ground truth is collected, we can train a classifier, and it knows what categories to set different type of tweets into. The other part is collection of live Twitter stream, the data that we actually do our work on, and this is collected through the Twitter streaming API. Now, the Twitter streaming API is where Twitter exposes data to developers for mining and research purposes. We send specific requests to get the data. The problem is that the Twitter streaming API is rate limited. This means that it can only service a limited amount of requests per unit time, and which makes data collection a very time-consuming process. Anyways, we have used the Twitter Python TwiP library to fetch data from this API. I've written a Python code in which this library is used, and we fetch the data and store it as into an ARFF file, which can be later used as an input to my classifier. Now let's come to the next topic of classification. Classification is a problem of identifying to which set of categories a new observation belongs to on the basis of a training set of data that had observations whose category was known. This means that this is a type of supervised learning in which the individual operations or observations are analyzed on the basis of particular attributes that are associated with that particular observation. Now, these attributes associated with the new incoming data can be used to classify it into categories that we have already known. Now, in our project, we use the Weka tool to do the classification, and we use the J48 classification algorithm to do so. The J48 algorithm is a Java implementation of one of the most known algorithms in the machine learning. It creates a decision tree based on the labeled data input. The pros are that it's very easy to interpret the results, and it helps to visualize the data through a decision tree. The con is that its complexity is very high, as it depends on the number of attributes. So if the number of attributes is very, very high, then the tree will be very deep and it will be very difficult to construct. It will also use a lot of space in that case scenario. But these cons are overshadowed by the fact that the J48 classifier ended up being very accurate. The J48 classifier has been trained using the ground truth. I have constructed a Java class called Construct Classifier, which imports libraries from Weka and uses the ground truth to train the J48 classifier. After this, the model of the J48 classifier is being stored into our system. The user fetch data from Twitter is also stored in the system, and once we have already made the J48 model, we can use this model to classify this data and label it according to our classifier. We have used another Java file to do this part. This is an example of the decision tree that has been built. As we can see, different levels have different attributes associated with them. The more important attributes might occupy higher positions in the decision tree, and as we go lower, there might be attributes that may or may not be as important. The most important part of any project is analyzing whether it works good enough or not, and we've used the Weka to do this for us. Now we only have a limited amount of labeled data, which is the ground truth, so we partition it into parts. One part is used to train the data, the classifier, and the other part is used to test the classifier. Now we've done this with different percentages. One was at 10, one was at 50, one was at 66%, and the results were startling. We had an accuracy of more than 94% in every of them, and it went as high as 99.8%. we can see that we have analyzed the results using Bekaa. In the left, we've constructed the confusion matrix for the test sets, and on the right, Bekaa has helped us identify the features that different features and how the spammers and the non-spammers differentiate in them. The red represents the spammer group and the blue represent the non-spammer group, and we can see that generally different there's massive differences between them in these particular aspects. In the end, I'd like to conclude by saying that the J48 classification technique was very, very accurate, even with very small data sets, and it shows that unsupervised learning and classification techniques are something that can be used for spam detection in the future. I would like to now go on to show my code. Now, for data collection, I've used these two Python files, which are using the TP library. And get trends gets the topics that are trending currently, and get users will actually get the tweets for those topics. Since there is a time constraint and collecting any amount of sensible data will take a very, very long time from the TP library, so we cannot afford to do so. So I'll just jump onto the Java part. In the Java file, I have created a file called construct classifier that is used to construct the classifier from using the Twitter ground truth, which is an ERFA file over here. So I'll just run that construct classifier now. As you can see, it says classifier built from the ground truth, and now when we look here, we can see a file called j48.model, which is the model file which is used to model the classifier that we've just constructed. Now that it's stored in local storage, we can access it anytime with to use on some unlabeled data set. So now we also have an unlabeled data set called check file, which we are going to classify using a classifier, and we are going to use the labeled data set file for that. So let's run that. It shows that the labeled data has set has been created and the number of spammers identified is 2. We can see that there was a new file generated over here called labeled, which is an ARFF file. Let's see what this file looks like. This is how the label.arff looks like, and it is pretty similar to the other arff files that we have. And the difference is that, unlike the check file, the labeled file is labeled with spammer or not, that we can see over here. This one is a spammer, so it's labeled yes, and this one is not, so it's labeled no. And it has been done successfully. I think this is all that my project does. I would like to thank you for your time for looking at my project. Thank you.